for coming out on a cold night. This, I think, is the fifth of the introductory course lectures, and this particular one is about our daily practice called Gongyo. So I hope those who are already doing Gongyo will get some understanding and inspiration from what I'm going to say, and those who have never done Gongyo will get anyway some idea of the purpose in our doing what sounds to be something very difficult indeed, but actually once you've got into the rhythm of it, becomes a joy. So really I think learning Gongyo is rather like learning to ride a bicycle. To begin with, you teeter about and find it very difficult. But suddenly, everything seems to click into place, if you really persevere. So if you're struggling to learn Gongyo now, or if you're looking at the Gongyo book and thinking, how am I ever going to learn it? Or if you're thinking, gosh, I think I can ever do this practice of Buddhism if I've got to learn a thing like that. What I promise you is, what has happened to everyone else, and everyone else can promise you, is that you really do reach a point after perhaps 2 months of doing it slowly and steadily, suddenly something seems to just click in your life and you find yourself in rhythm, exactly like learning to ride a bicycle. So really, Gongyo, I think myself, and I guess anyone who's tried it and is doing it, is an incredibly powerful form of prayer. And the purpose of my talk this evening is to explain why that is so. So I should start by saying something about what Nichiren Daishonin said concerning practice to the Gohonzon. And this is a quotation from a Gosho called Reply to Lady Nichinyo. And it reads as follows. Never seek this Gohonzon outside yourself. The Gohonzon exists within the mortal flesh of us ordinary people who embrace the Lotus Sutra and chant Nam-myoho Renge-kyo. To be endowed with the 10 worlds means that all the 10 worlds, without exception, are contained in the one world of Buddhahood. Only with faith can one enter Buddhahood. So faith in Buddhism is action. That is to say, action to practice exactly as the Buddha taught. And the practice of Gongyo is exactly as the Buddha taught us to do. So if we do Gongyo, day in, day out, we will, combined with the other two practices of teaching others and study, we will, in this lifetime, attain Buddhahood. The very practice of Gongyo is to open gradually the doors to your Buddha state. So when Nichiren Daishonin said at the beginning, never seek this Gohonzon outside yourself, the Gohonzon exists within the mortal flesh of us ordinary people who embrace the Lotus Sutra and chant Nam-myoho Renge-kyo. He means that when you practice to the Gohonzon, which you've already had a lecture about, what you're in fact doing is entering it. Or if you like, fusing your life with it. Or in other words, you're realizing that your life is the Gohonzon. And that the Gohonzon that was inscribed by Nichiren Daishonin is a mirror of your life itself. So this purpose, the purpose of this practice called Gongyo is, as it were, to enter the Gohonzon. Over months and years of doing it, you gradually open the doors of your life and realize that you also, just as the Buddha promised, possess the Buddha state, the highest state of human life. So, in achieving this state, of course we have to purify our life and put it in balance and rhythm. So, looking at it from perhaps a shallower point of view, the purpose of our daily gongyo, our daily practice, is to put our life in perfect balance and rhythm, to purify it, in other words. Sometimes people say practicing gongyo is like digging a pipeline down through your life to its depths where the Buddha state lies. When you're learning gongyo, perhaps a little bit painfully struggling with it every day, and allowing precious time in order to learn it, you're digging that pipeline down gradually through all the layers of your life until finally you hit the Buddha state. Once you do that, of course, it's then necessary to keep the pipeline open. And that is what the daily practice is all about, to purify your life every day so that the pipeline to Buddhahood is pure and clean. And the great qualities of Buddhahood, which are compassion, and wisdom, life force and courage and so on, can actually flow freely and cleanly through your life. And then, of course, having done that practice of gongyo, you then carry out the fundamental practice of this teaching, which is to chant Nam-myoho Renge Kyo over and over again. In other words, by the time you are chanting Nam-myoho Renge Kyo, your life is perfectly in balance, perfectly purified, and therefore your great prayers as you chant Daimoku will propel themselves outwards and inwards with maximum effect. So the gyo of gongyo means practice. Gyo, G-Y-O. And the gon of gongyo, G-O-N, means assiduous, or it could mean eager, or endeavoring strongly, striving hard. All those things can be meant by the character that's pronounced gon. So in other words, gongyo is assiduous practice, or practice involving strong endeavor, or eager and enthusiastic practice. So in a way you could say gongyo means let's go, something like that. So gongyo and its formula is entirely based on the law of cause and effect, which we've also discussed in a number of lectures before. Through that great effort to do this assiduous practice, your determination to do it well, you are making an incredibly pure cause which will bring an incredibly pure effect or benefit into your life. So as you know, cause and effect are exactly related to each other. You do something great and something great will occur in return to you. You do something destructive and something destructive will occur to you. So gongyo is a very pure cause to make. You give up your time. Maybe you have to get up half an hour earlier in the morning to do it. That takes effort, but it brings incredible reward. So of course nothing is free, is it, in this life? We have to work for everything. If one's going to win a race or play golf well or tennis or be an expert at any particular field of science or the arts, you have to work at it. If you want to attain the highest state of human life and be happy, then you have to work for it. And that work is to do Gongyo every day. So how did this all begin? You know, how was this practice of Gongyo conjured up in the wisdom of the Buddha? Well, it started, of course, with Nichiren Daishonin himself. Nichiren Daishonin said that we should, first of all, read, recite, and chant two chapters of the Lotus Sutra, which were the key chapters in which the meaning of the whole of that sutra was contained. They are the Hoben chapter and the Juryo chapter, part of which, and only part of which, we recite in Gongyo. These were the key words, in other words, of the Lotus Sutra. But Nichiren Daishonin said, if you recite the Hoben and Juryo chapter, it's as if you are reciting all 28 chapters of the Lotus Sutra, because the meaning is all contained in those two. And since the Lotus Sutra embraces all the other sutras that have ever been taught in Buddhism, all 80,000 of them, to recite the Hoben and Juryo chapters of the Lotus Sutra is to recite all the sutras of all the Buddhas. So to recite those two chapters is embracing in your life all the teachings of all the Buddhas since time began. The actual form of Gongyo, of course, the other thing which Nichiren Daishonin said was the basic practice of chanting Nammyoho Renge Kyo over and over again to your heart's content, he said. And I'll talk about those words, to your heart's content, a bit later. So with these two guidelines from Nichiren Daishonin, round about the 13th or the 14th century, no one exactly knows the date, the high priest of Nichiren Shoshu decided to establish a firm practice of Gongyo, which the priests at the head temple would carry out daily. And this involved moving in procession from temple to temple within the precincts of the head temple itself and reciting the various prayers of Gongyo. As you know, we do to this day five prayers in the morning and three in the evening. So each of those prayers was carried out at a different temple. After they'd completed one prayer, they would move to the next temple to complete the next one. And of course, each temple had some significant relationship with the prayer itself. So that is how Gongyo began, conducted only by the priests. The lay people didn't do Gongyo. In those days, in the early days of Nichiren Shoshu, the action was entirely left to the priests, and the lay people's task was to support the priests. So certainly the lay people would chant Nammyoho Renge Kyo, and sometimes they might recite the sutra because they knew Nichiren Daishonin said they should, but there was no, as it were, formal practice that had been devised in the wisdom of the high priests, carried out by the lay people. And it wasn't, in fact, until after World War II, when religion was freed or liberated in Japan, and people were permitted to practice as they please, that the president of the lay society, whose name was Toda, Mr. Toda, asked the permission of the high priest for the lay people to now actually practice Gongyo themselves in the same way exactly as the priests. The reason for that is, of course, that a new phase of the great movement for world peace, or Kosen Rufu, began at that time, and the lay people's responsibility became extremely important. Therefore, of course, they needed the life force and the wisdom and the compassion to carry out this great movement, just in exactly the same way as the priests. So now, a bit about the form of Gongyo. for those of you who have not yet done it or know little about it, it really consists of three sections. The first section, you chant or recite the sutras, the two chapters that I mentioned. And in the second section, you make silent prayer. And in the third section, you chant Daimoku. That is to say, you chant Namyoho Rengekyo. So in the morning you do five different prayers, each of which is preceded by a recitation of the sutra. And then finally you do the chanting and then conclude. So there are three distinct parts of the practice: reciting the sutra, saying the silent prayer, and actually chanting Namyoho Rengekyo. And I'll explain the reasons for this in a moment or two. So the purpose, as I said, is to purify your life. What is it that you're actually purifying? The answer to that is that you are overcoming, in the process of that practice, the negativity that exists in your life, inherently in every single one of us, and transforming that into a positive force for value. So you're overcoming in that process desires that are purely shallow and selfish, and broadening and widening your life into desires which have value and which are creative for good, both in your own life and in other people's lives. So you can really feel this, those who've done Gongyo, you can really feel this purification. Somehow, the world does look brighter when you've completed Gongyo. I remember thinking that the first time that I've ever noticed how beautiful trees are in winter was after I'd really learned to do Gongyo properly. I'd never noticed it before, but my senses were so pure. So everything is purified, and all that negativity, that destructive quality, which causes us so much trouble in life, is cleared in the process of that Gongyo. So this is why, of course, we do it twice a day. So you do Gongyo in the morning when you get up. Through the night, your life has become very jumbled. During sleep, you dream, you have maybe nightmares. Whatever happens, one's life is always in a bit of a jumble when you wake up in the morning. Sometimes people have the most negative of their thoughts when they're shaving. Or if you're not shaving, when you're making your first cup of tea or coffee. So after that jumble which has occurred while you're sleeping, you need to purify your life again and get it into balance. It's true, isn't it? We can really feel off balance when we get out of bed and get up in the morning. The purpose of Gongyo is to put your life straight away in balance. And in the evening, we've come back home maybe from a day's work. There'd be many problems, difficulties, obstacles, people getting angry and irritated all around one, the rush and the pressure of daily life. We need to put our life into balance again in order to spend enjoyable, valuable, constructive sort of evening and go to sleep happily. So at that point, perhaps I should have mentioned it's evening Gongyo, not good night Gongyo. It should be done in the evening while one's still reasonably fresh. If one does it just before one goes to bed, then you're droopy and tired, and really all you feel like is getting into bed and going to sleep. So it is an evening practice, normally conducted, but depending on people's work or daily timetable, normally done between about 4 o'clock and about 8 or 9 in the evening, while one's still fresh. I've talked about this purification. What is that process? Is the next point I'm sure you're thinking in your head. What am I digging this pipeline down through? And without going into a lot of detail, because it could be a lecture on its own, I think I'd better explain at this point that Buddhism teaches that we have 9 consciousnesses. 9 consciousnesses, it is, which you have to go through in order to reach the 9th, which is the state or the consciousness of Buddha. So the first 5 are very simple. They're one's ordinary senses of hearing, seeing, tasting, smelling, so on. The 6th consciousness is your thinking mind. Any psychiatrist will agree with this so far. The 7th consciousness is the first layer of your subconscious. And that is the area of your desires, your ego, in other words. Of course, Buddhism, Nichiren Shoshu Buddhism, teaches the importance of desires. Some religions try to deny desire. But Buddhism points out that desire is an inevitable part of life. And what is more, is an important part of life, because it's a driving force. Therefore, Nichiren Shoshu Buddhism follows the principle of turning desires into enlightenment. Through your great effort to fulfill your desires, you chant Nammyoho Rengekyo, which in its turn is so strong a force that inevitably it brings you into the Buddha state. So even if your desires are wrongly directed in a way that could harm you or others, they'll be turned in the process of chanting to a positive and valuable direction. So those desires arrive out of the 7th consciousness. And the 8th consciousness is a vast area. Often it's been said that the subconscious and the conscious areas of one's life are like the tip of an iceberg to the huge area under the water. The subconscious is enormous. So the 8th subconscious, or as some psychiatrists call it, in psychology, the collective subconscious, is the area where all your experiences of all your whole eternal life are stored. If at one time the entity that is you went through the stage of swimming in the sea and then developing little legs and crawling out onto the mud and eventually creating or evolving some sort of a body that could withstand life on land, all those memories are there. The memory of your babyhood, the memory when you were in your mother's womb, everything is stored in that amazing area of the 8th consciousness. So you can understand, therefore, that that is the area where your karma or destiny is stored. All the effects of all the causes that you've ever made in your eternal life are contained in the huge sea of the 8th consciousness.